It was supposed to be just another routine flight. On the morning of November 4th, 2010, Qantas Flight 32 lifted off from Singapore's Changi Airport, bound for Sydney. The giant Airbus A380, one of the most advanced aircraft in the world, was carrying 469 people, soaring smoothly through clear skies over the Indonesian coastline. Everything appeared normal, calm, controlled, silent. But at 37,000 feet, silence can be deceiving. Just 4 minutes after reaching cruising altitude, without warning, one of the aircraft's engines exploded with terrifying force. It wasn't just an engine failure, it was a chain reaction, a violent eruption that tore through critical systems, severed hydraulics, punctured fuel lines, and left the aircraft hemorrhaging power. The aircraft was the largest passenger plane ever built. However, it was no longer flying by the book, and for the next harrowing hour and a half, its survival would depend on something far more fragile than metal and engines, human judgment. So, what caused that engine to explode? How close did the world come to witnessing another devastating air disaster? This is the story of Qantas Flight 32, and how it came terrifyingly close to becoming one of aviation's worst disasters. It began as a clear, calm morning in Singapore, November 4th, 2010. The air was warm, humid, as always in the tropics, but visibility was excellent. No storms, no wind shear, no ominous clouds on the horizon. Just another ordinary day at Changi Airport. It is one of the busiest and most efficient airports in the world. Runway operations were smooth. Air traffic control was calm. No delays, no hiccups. In the terminals, travelers sipped their coffee, checked their phones, and waited to board their flights. They were completely unaware that one of those flights was about to make aviation history. Parked at gate C23 was a giant of the skies. Qantas Flight 32, operated by an Airbus A380, tail number VH-OQA, the very first A380 delivered to Qantas. At the time, this aircraft represented the cutting edge of commercial aviation. Twin deck, four engines, advanced avionics, and built for comfort and efficiency on long-haul routes. Inside, the cabin crew was making final checks. Passengers were settling into their seats, some flipping through magazines, some already half asleep, others casually watching the flight attendants demonstrate safety procedures they never expected to need. In the cockpit, a seasoned crew, Captain Richard de Crespigny in command, with more than 30 years of flying experience. Alongside him, two senior first officers and a second officer. One of the most experienced flight crews ever assembled, though none of them knew it yet, that experience was about to be tested in a way few pilots ever face. At 10:01 in the morning, Flight 32 began its slow to the runway. Engines humming, systems green, checklists complete. The flight to Sydney, just over 7 hours, was expected to be smooth and uneventful. But fate had other plans, because just 4 minutes after takeoff, everything would change. As we move into the events that followed, hit the subscribe button to make sure you don't miss the dramatic twist that unfolds next. After lifting off from Singapore's Changi Airport, Qantas Flight 32 was climbing through 7,000 feet above the shimmering coastline of Batam Island, Indonesia. And then it happened. Boom! A deafening explosion rocked the aircraft so loud that passengers thought a bomb had gone off. In the cockpit, warning alarms flooded the displays. The number two engine had suffered an uncontained engine failure. The number two engine is the inboard engine on the left wing. That means the engine didn't just fail. It exploded from the inside out, ripping itself apart in midair and blasting high-velocity shrapnel outward into the wing. Within seconds, fragments tore through vital systems. Pieces of the engine punctured the wing structure and sliced into multiple fuel tanks, triggering cascading fuel leaks. One fragment started a small fire in a fuel tank. Another severed part of the hydraulic system. More shrapnel compromised the anti-lock braking system and even impacted the electronic control systems that manage the number one and number four engines, causing both to enter a degraded state. They weren't lost, but they were no longer performing at full capacity. The aircraft was now bleeding fuel, missing hydraulic control, and flying with three partially functioning engines. Parts of the landing flaps were damaged. The number one engine couldn't be properly controlled. Even with all these failures, the pilots had no choice but to keep flying. Inside the cockpit, the crew was hit with over 60 caution and warning messages in just moments. It was chaos on the screens, but the aircraft was amazingly still controllable. Rather than rushing back immediately, the crew made the critical decision to enter a holding pattern near Singapore, circling above the ocean as they worked to understand just how badly the aircraft had been damaged. It took them 50 minutes, almost a full hour, just to sort through the systems and piece together a picture of what was still working and what wasn't. Among the crew were some of Qantas's most experienced pilots. They consulted the landing performance software, called the LDPA, to figure out if they could even land the plane safely. But when they entered the numbers, an overweight landing by 50 tons, systems degraded, damage across multiple control surfaces, it is the program refused to calculate a landing distance. For a moment, it looked like they had no good options. Then they tried something unconventional. They removed the input for a wet runway, because they knew the surface at Changi was dry. With that adjustment, the LDPA gave them an answer. Yes, the landing was possible, but barely. They would come to a stop with only 100 meters, about 330 feet of runway left. At 11:45 in the morning, nearly 2 hours after takeoff, Qantas Flight 32 began its final approach. The crew used gravity to manually drop the landing gear. It is an emergency backup system that bypassed hydraulics. They landed at a speed 35 knots faster than normal, the brakes straining under the force. Four tires burst on touchdown. And then came another problem. The number one engine wouldn't shut down. Fuel was leaking from the left wing. The brakes were glowing hot from maximum braking effort. And now an engine continued to spin. The crew feared the worst. A fire or explosion during evacuation. They kept everyone on board. Cabin crew stood ready to deploy the slides in an instant, but Captain Evans decided the safest place for the moment was inside the aircraft. Emergency crews sprayed the rogue engine with fire suppressant until it finally flamed out. With only battery power remaining and a single working VHF radio, the crew coordinated calmly and precisely with airport fire crews, and eventually, passengers were led off the plane, not by slides, but by a single set of stairs, slowly, methodically, and safely. Not a single person was hurt. All 440 passengers and 29 crew survived what would go down as one of the most complex and serious midair mechanical failures in aviation history. But the debris from that shattered engine, chunks of titanium and composite rained down over Batam Island. Some struck a schoolyard. Others damaged homes. One piece landed on a car. So here's the question. How did this plane survive? What really happened inside that engine? And how close did Qantas Flight 32 come to becoming the first fatal crash of an Airbus A380? Stick with us, we're just getting started. The answer wasn't simple, but when investigators from the Australian Transport Safety Bureau, ATSB, rolled up their sleeves and opened up the wrecked engine, the truth began to emerge, and it was disturbing. Inside the number two Rolls-Royce Trent 900 engine, they found what looked like a smoking gun, a small stub pipe. It is a tiny part with a massive responsibility. And that was cracked. The crack wasn't sudden. It had been forming slowly, quietly, invisibly, over time. It was a textbook case of fatigue cracking, the kind of failure that doesn't happen all at once but creeps in from repeated stress. But why did it crack in the first place? The answer? A manufacturing flaw. Rolls-Royce later admitted that during production, this tiny oil pipe hadn't been aligned correctly when it was drilled out. The misaligned counter-bore process left one side of the pipe wall too thin, so thin that it couldn't handle the stress. Eventually, that weakness gave way. Oil began to leak. And when oil meets heat inside a roaring jet engine, there's only one likely outcome: fire. That fire burned hot and fast, and in seconds, it compromised the engine's intermediate pressure turbine, IPT disc. It is a spinning chunk of metal critical to the engine's operation. The disc broke apart, and massive fragments blasted out like cannonballs. One piece sliced through systems, another ripped wiring clean in half. A third punched into the aircraft's structure. One of the fragments even severed the wiring that would have shut down the number one engine after landing, which is why the crew couldn't turn it off and had to rely on fire crews instead. It was the kind of cascading failure engineers design entire planes to avoid. And yet here it was in real life. Airbus and Rolls-Royce were both alarmed. The Airbus engineers confirmed the disc had fired off three separate high-energy fragments. These weren't small metal shards. They were deadly projectiles. And the plane was lucky more systems weren't destroyed. In response, aviation authorities moved quickly. On November 10, 2010, just days after the incident, the European Aviation Safety Agency, EASA, issued an emergency directive. Every airline flying the Trent 900 engine had to carry out urgent and detailed inspections, including oil pipe checks, turbine blade exams, and structural assessments. They even had to run the engines at idle for extended periods just to detect any irregularities. But as investigators learned more, some of these requirements were eased. What remained clear, though, was that every Trent 900 engine in the world needed to be checked. And when they were, the results were chilling. Of the 45 engines first examined, three failed and were immediately removed from service. As inspections widened, that number rose. By mid-2011, 53 engines had been pulled. Some had oil pipes that were dangerously thin. Others had no records showing the pipe had even been measured correctly during manufacturing. This wasn't just a fluke. It was a wake-up call. Don't forget to hit that notification bell so you're always up to date on the latest in aviation safety. On June 22, 2011, Qantas and Rolls-Royce reached a quiet but powerful agreement: $95 million Australian in compensation. That's around $100 million US, or 62 million pounds. A figure big enough to fix a plane, but more importantly, big enough to send a message. If you build engines for the world's largest passenger jet, you can't afford even a single mistake. By the time VHOQA rolled back into Australia on April 22, 2012, it had been out of service for nearly a year and a half. It returned to passenger duty just 6 days later, on April 28th. The price of those repairs? An eye-watering $139 million Australian, roughly $145 million US. And as a final twist, all those reinforcements added about 94 kilograms, 207 pounds, to the aircraft's weight. In aviation, every kilo counts. But this time, it was a price worth paying. For the passengers who boarded that flight, and for the crew who flew it, the memory of those harrowing moments will never fade. As we reflect on what happened that day, we have to ask, what would we do in the face of such a crisis? We may never know until it happens. But thanks to the brave individuals on that flight, the world knows it's possible to rise above the chaos and come out on top. Thank you for joining us as we explored one of the most intense chapters in aviation history. Stay safe, stay curious, and keep your eyes on the skies.